Hello and welcome to Honors Function. In this second lecture on exponential functions, we're going to explore the property of an exponential function. We will derive this property from looking at the graph of an exponential function, not from the definition. Again, remember the definition is a little bit complicated and it involves a limit, okay? So we're just gonna look at the graph of exponential function. Let's begin by recalling the definition of an exponential function. So to define the exponential function in base a, which we write like that, we first need to take a base that is above zero. Okay, remember that the base has to be above zero so that the function will be a real valued function, okay? Then x base a of x is defined to be a to the power of x, where x is a real number. Now, this is a novelty in this definition, is that the exponent is a real number, okay? Therefore, the domain of any exponential base a is, of course, all real number, and this is the first property of an exponential function. Their domain is all real numbered, okay? So now let's look at the graph of various exponential functions. I'm gonna take my notes. I have several graphs in my notes. All right, so here are a few graphs. The first thing you notice is the two families of graph. Here, the base is indicated on the graph. This family are functions that are going up. Remember that you have to read a function from left to right, okay? So these are going up, and these are going down. Now, going up is increasing, going down is decreasing. And if you look at the base, all these bases are above one, and all these bases are below one, okay? So this is the first property. If the base is above one, the function is increasing. If the base is below one, the function is decreasing, okay? The other thing we notice is that for the base above one, the x-axis seems to be an asymptote as x approaches negative infinity. And for the base smaller than one, the x-axis is an asymptote as x approaches plus infinity, okay? So for this right here, we would write with a limit notation, we would write that the limit of a to the x as x approaches infinity is zero if a is smaller than one. Now remember that a is positive, so I guess I could double frame it, a between zero and one right here. And for describing this type of behavior, we would say that the limit of a to the x is equal to zero as x approaches negative infinity when the bases are above one, okay? Now remember, we're not looking at the base of one because the base of one is a constant function and it's always equal to one, and that is not very interesting, okay? So we don't look at this base right here. All right. So here are a couple of properties. The other thing we've noticed also is that if you take one graph, of course, there are many graphs right here, right? But if you focus only on one graph, then all exponential functions are one-to-one, all right? They will all pass the horizontal line test. Now, of course, you only have to look at one graph, right? And you can see an horizontal line will cut the graph in one single point, all right? That's it. Okay, so they all pass the horizontal line test. They are all one-to-one. Now, the other thing we noted also that is of importance is that I don't see any graph below the x-axis. There is no graph below the x-axis. What does it mean? That means that the range of any exponential function is 0 infinity. Also, why 0 right here not taken? Because they're never equal to zero, okay? So an exponential base a is always strictly above zero. You have to remember that, right? For example, if one day you have to solve an equation like this right here, well, that will not have any solution because you cannot have an exponential negative, all right? So this is something else we notice. And finally, let's also say that all the graphs are smooth and continuous, okay? You remember, smooth means there is no sharp turn, and continuous means they are all unbroken. You don't have to lift up your pencil to plot them. Now you can see right here, I've represented the output when the input is one, and right here, the output when the input is negative 1. Now, for the negative 1 output, I took the graph of these functions when the base is smaller than 1, and for the 1 I took the graph of this function. Let's notice something else. Look at, for example, if I look at base 5 right here, here's a base 5, and here's a base 1/5. They surely look symmetric with respect to the y-axis, right? Look at the base 3/2 and 2/3. They look symmetric. 2 and 1/2. Same thing, they really look symmetric. Well, this is not an appearance. Let's show it right now. It's very simple. Let's take a base 1 over a. So x base 1 over a of x, what is this? This is, the base is 1 over a to the x, right? Now 1 over a is the same as a to the negative 1 to the x, which is the same as a to the negative x, which is x base a of negative x, right? How do you go from y equals x base a of x to y equals x base a of negative x? How do you do that? Well, if you take a base a of x, let's take an a above 1 right here, x base a of negative x would be symmetric with respect to the y axis. But we said that this is just the same as x base 1 over a of x, and that's why basically you never have to look at bases smaller than 1. You can always look at a base above 1 if you take the symmetric with respect to the y-axis, okay? So this is a symmetric property of these graphs. They are all written in my notes, so let's check out quickly the places where I wrote all these properties. Here is where all the properties are written. You need to know that very, very well, okay? Let's go over some examples right now. All right, example number 1. Solve this equation. So this is an equation. I do have an exponential on the right side. Actually, I have a product of two exponentials on the right side, and they have different bases, right? And I have a number on the left side. What am I going to use to solve this equation? I'm going to use this property. I'm going to use a one-to-one property. An equality of output implies an equality of input. That says that the function is 1-to-1. The exponential base a function is a 1-to-1 function, okay? Because of course this is always true, right? So we need the same base on both sides. Can I get the same base right here? What's going to be the common base? You need to figure this out as soon as you start the problem. The common base right here, of course, is going to be 2, base 2, right? So I don't change the first factor, 2 to the x plus 1. Here, this is 2 cubed to the negative x equals 2 to the 4 right here. So 2 to the x plus 1 times 2 to the negative 3x equals 2 to the 4 right here. All right, here, let's put if and only if, if and only if. So then we have 2 to the negative 2x plus 1, right? You have to add the exponent, equals 2 to the 4. That's it. I can now use this property right here. And so I have that negative 2x plus 1 equals 4, or x equals negative 3/2. That's it. Okay? X equals negative 3/2 is the solution. Do I need to check it? No, I don't have to check it. I did not introduce any extraneous solution by using this property. Okay, you don't introduce extraneous solution by using this property. Let's move on. So please do the second example, which I may have called 1 in my notes, and I'm going to show you how to deal with the third, and here again. This is actually the fifth example, and I still call it 1. I guess you have to do all the ones except the first, right? How do we solve this equation? Well, this is actually a quadratic equation. Okay, and so is this. This is a quadratic equation too. So a quadratic equation in what? Well, here it's a quadratic equation in 3 to the x. While this one, and I'll let you solve this one right here, it's a quadratic equation in 2 to the x, okay? So how do we solve this? Well, I'm just gonna use the quadratic tools that I have to solve any quadratic equation. And the easiest one is to factor, right? You can factor, complete the square, or use a quadratic formula. I'm gonna try to factor that. But first, where is my quadratic equation here? Right here, check it out, look. Here's something squared, and here's gonna be the same thing, but now linear. Where's that thing? This is 3 to the x, right? 3 to the x squared is 3 to the 2x, and this is 3 to the x, minus 8 times minus 9 equals 0. So the equation that you are thinking about is a squared minus 8a minus 9 equals 0. And this is easily factored, right? So it is 3x minus 9 times 3x plus 1 equals 0, right? So now how do we solve that? Well, that means here, this is if and only if. If and only if, I'm not introducing any extraneous root. 3x is 9, or 3x is negative 1. Well, 3x is negative 1, that has no solution because of the range of an exponential, right? 3x has to be strictly above 0. 3x equals 9 has a solution, and that's x equals 2. That's it. That's my solution, okay? The only solution to this equation is x equals 2. Please do the next one, number 5, and also number 6, which I have no idea what I called at this point. Okay, so the one I called number 5 above was actually number 4. I'm sure you noticed that. Anyway, I'll let you rectify all of my enumerations, okay? Let's do some other problem involving limits. So these are actually pretty simple if you recall the basic graph of an exponential function. And before I do that, actually, let me go over the most important aspect of this lesson. At this point, you have to be able to clearly sketch an exponential function, and I expect you to use 2 points on it, okay? So if a is above 1, this is what I'd like to see. At least 2 points. It goes like this right here, okay? And the 2 points are this one, when the input is 0, the output is always 1. It doesn't matter what the base is, okay? The output is always 1. And when the input is 1, the output is always the base, 1a, right? Makes sense? Okay? This is when the base is above 1, an increasing graph. And the other families is when the base is smaller than 1. So what 2 points I want to see at least on the graph? Same one right here, when the input is 0, you still go through 0, 1, okay? And here, if it is negative 1, so for this you have to understand that a is smaller than 1, okay? So if a is smaller than 1, for example, if a is 1/3, what is a to the negative 1? A to the negative 1 would be 1/3 to the negative 1, and that is just 3, right? So if you take a smaller than 1, right here, you have 1 over a, and that is a very nice number. 1 over a is going to be a very nice number, probably an integer. It doesn't have to be, like if you take a equals 2/3, then 1 over a would be 3/2, 1.5, okay? But it may be an integer in many cases, right? So this is a very nice point. Now, of course, if you're dealing with an easy graph, for example, if you take y equals 2x, I want to see many more points on the graph, right? I mean, it's a very easy graph to plot, this one, all right? So you need to have these two types of graph always in your mind when you're dealing with exponential function. Let's now go over the limit problem. All right, so I'm looking at the limit at negative infinity of an exponential whose base is smaller than 1. So basically, I have something like this, and the limit at negative infinity is plus infinity, right here. Okay, so please do number 7. Let me do number 8. So here, be careful, we have a small graph shifting right here. We start with an exponential whose base is smaller than 1, like that. And we multiply this by 3 and then by negative 1. So the multiplication by 3 is just going to stretch it like this. We still have the same asymptote right here, right? And then the minus 1 will flip it, right? It will flip it across this. So I have something like this. And I want the limit at plus infinity. I'm right here. And so the limit is 0. All right. Okay, let me do number 9 now. For this one, you're gonna have to look at all the different pieces of this function. This is actually called a logistic function, and we're going to study them. X approaches infinity. Where's x? X is right here. X is involved in this exponential right here. And that's the first thing I want to look at. What am I looking at? I'm looking at an exponential whose base is smaller than 1. Therefore, I'm looking at this right here, okay? And this would be y equals 0.43 to the x. And then I'm looking at plus infinity. So I'm right here. And so this piece approaches 0. Okay, that little piece approaches 0. If you multiply this by 5, it's still going to approach 0, right? So that piece now approaches 0. What do you do to that piece? You're adding 4. So the whole denominator is going to approach 4. And what do you do with that? You take 25 divided by something that comes close to 4. 25 divided by something that is very close to 4 is going to be very close to 25 over 4. That's it. Okay? Please do the next one. Let's go over one last type of example and we'll be done with this lecture. Alright, here's a typical question that you will see on some assessment. Determine the domain, the range, the equation of the asymptotes. Determine if it is increasing or decreasing and on which interval. Now, that actually, it's always either increasing or decreasing, right? So we just need to know if it's increasing or decreasing. It will not change on an interval. And then find the limit at plus or minus infinity. Think in terms of graph shifting. So this is what we're going to do. I'm going to take the function y equals 1/3 to the x, and I'm going to graph shift it to this right here. Okay, so let's take 1/3 to the x, base is smaller than 1. I don't need to be precise here. Here's the first one, right here. Number 1 is y equals 1/3 to the x. Number 2, what do? We want y equals 1/3 to the x minus 1. So what does it do? That simply moves this one unit to the right, right? So it's going to be something like this. Like this. Here we go. That's number 2. Right here. Okay? Number 3, what do you do in number 3? You do y equals 1/3 negative x minus 1. What does it do? It flips it across the y-axis. So you take the blue graph right here and you flip it across the y-axis. Here's number 3, right there, right? So then number 4, what do? Number 4, we multiply by 2. So number 4 is y equals 2 times 1/3 to the power of negative x minus 1. What does it do? Well, it slightly multiplies all slightly. It multiplies all the y's by 2, right? So you multiply. So these are tiny, tiny y. Multiplying by 2 is not going to be a big difference. And then right here, everything should be multiplied by 2, right? So if this is 1, this should be another 1 right there. Okay, multiply by 2, like that. And finally, minus 5. That's the last one now. That's going to introduce a pretty important change. So the fifth one is y equals 2 times 1/3 of negative x minus 1 minus 5. So you take the green one and it goes down 5 units. Okay, the green one right here goes down 5 units. Right here, 5 units. Okay, so you're going to have a graph like this. Like that. Okay, what was the horizontal asymptote of the green graph? Well, it is x equals 0, y equals 0, right? Y equals 0. And therefore, when you move it by 5, this asymptote is going to be y equals negative 5, okay? It's actually always here, and that makes sense. All right, let's answer all the questions now. So first, we want the domain. I don't need to look at the graph. The domain for all these exponential are all real number. The range, well, the range, you can see it's above negative 5, right? So it's negative 5 infinity. Equation of the asymptotes. Equation of the asymptote is y equals negative 5, right? Okay. Increasing or decreasing? Well, the final red graph is always increasing. Always increasing. And finally, the limit. So here, the limit of the given graph, I'm going to call that y, as x approaches plus infinity, and the limit of y as x approaches negative infinity. So plus infinity, where are you going? Up, and really quickly. I'll go in class over what I talked about in my note, how quick they grow. And at negative infinity, what's the limit? Well, it's the asymptote. It is negative 5. That's it. I hope everything is clear. It should all be a review, maybe with a little bit more detail, but not much. Thank you for watching.